my notes.
Hey, and welcome to the weekly research symposium speaker series hosted by the research office. We have the Dean Ben Hartline and Vice Chancellor Ben Hartline over here, hosted by the School of Arts and Sciences, which is really called CLSPS, but I have no idea what that stands for, so I'll just say Arts and Sciences. It's my pleasure today to introduce my colleague in the history of technology, Jim LeCain, a professor at MSU in Bozeman. The topic of our talk today is death in Butte's Berkeley pit. What 342, not 340 as we originally made a typo, but 342 dead Snokies tell us about the nature of humans. The talk is based on Professor LeCain's investigation of the 1995 death of these snow geese that landed on our Berkeley pit, along with a whole string of incidents back to 1905 and the death of thousands of animals, horses and other livestock as well as wildlife that grazed on the contaminated pastures near the Anaconda smelter. He compares environmental disasters in Montana's past with catastrophes elsewhere in the world and tells some crackling good yarns about his findings. The deaths at first seem to symbolize what happens when humans and nature collide, but LeCain started us thinking about how humans might be completely natural too. So perhaps humans are an expression of nature and not merely its shaper. As he says, we need to kind of get over ourselves. The planet may actually have it in for us. Timothy James LeCain is an award-winning historian of the global material environment. His first book, Mass Destruction, won the 2010 Best Book of the Year Award from the American Society for Environmental History and was chosen an Outstanding Book of the Year by Choice, the review publication of the American Library Association. Mike is familiar with that. In 2009, LeCain and his colleague Brett Walker were awarded a $300,000 National Science Foundation grant to pursue collaborative research comparing Japanese and American responses to pollution from massive copper mining operations that began in the late 19th century, something that we're very familiar with here in Duke, America. From 2011 to 2012, Tim was a senior fellow at the Rachel Carson Center in Munich, Germany, a global center for the study of environmental humanities. Next year, 2016, he will be a fellow at the Oslo Center for Advanced Studies, a preeminent Norwegian institution for interdisciplinary academic research. He's currently an associate professor of history and the director of graduate studies at Montana State University in Bozeman, where he lives with his wife and two delightful children. Tim, it's all yours.
Great. Well, thank you for that generous introduction, Pat. And thank you to Montana Tech for sponsoring this. I sort of invited myself. And because, as you'll see, I have a bit of an agenda here today. And I'll get to that. But thank you for all of you for coming out, too. I'm delighted to see so many of you here today. I think three basic things I want to do today with the 45-50 minutes allotted to me. The first is, of course, to talk about the Butte snow geese and to consider what the Butte snow geese, the Berkeley pit snow geese, might tell us about ourselves, about the human relationship to nature. To get to that, about in the middle of the talk, this is kind of a warning, there's about a 20-minute part where I'm going to talk about some big ideas, some big sort of theoretical stuff that I hope will be presented in an entertaining manner. But you may be sort of thinking, where's the snow geese? But they'll be back, I promise you, because I think it'll help us to think about the snow geese in interesting, productive ways. And then finally, I have a pitch. I kind of have a little pitch here at the end to try to encourage you to perhaps become involved with this this topic. Okay, but with that in mind, let me begin by taking you back to that cold November night, now almost exactly 20 years ago. And if you could have been there, I think it would have been one of the most extraordinary sights to behold. To hundreds of ghostly white forms dropping from the black sky, like a feathered heavenly host, raucous angels from the mysterious frozen land to the north, now come back to Earth. Ornithologists had once called them Hyperborea. That's Latin for beyond the realm of the north wind. Struck by the birds' brilliant white plumage, speakers of plain English simply called them snow geese. The flock arrived on a bitter, stormy night in mid-November 1995. High winds may have blown them off course, or perhaps they lost their way in the dense clouds that roiled the high Rocky Mountain peaks that night. Uncertain where to go, the tired birds apparently circled the valley several times, probably searching for water. A pond or a marsh where they could land and rest, drink and eat. They found something else. Not a pond with its familiar green corona of grass and reeds, but water nonetheless, abundant even, though strangely sunken at the bottom of a huge funnel-shaped hole in the hard rock of the earth. The temptation too great, more than 300 of the birds flared their broad wings and glided down the steeply stepped banks, settling their bellies into the cold acid water of Montana's Berkeley pit, or buttes. They came unseen, they died unheard. Soon their raucous calls faded into a cold November silence. When a crew from the Montana Bureau of Mines finally discovered their bodies floating on the glossy surface of the pit lake, they saw perhaps 100, 150 of the birds, but the birds' snowy white feathers had been stained the same rusty red as the pit water. And by the time the workers pulled the last corpse from the pit, the death count was 342. Now, in the days and months afterwards, the national media picked up the story. There were articles in the New York Times, the High Country News, long, poignant essays in popular magazines like Outside. Humans asked themselves, who or what had killed the birds? The Atlantic Richfield Company, or ARCO, had bought the pit from the once mighty Anaconda Company almost two decades earlier. And based on a few preliminary autopsies, the company concluded that the geese had died from eating wheat contaminated with a poisonous fungus. Environmental groups in the state of Montana disagreed. Sheer common sense suggested the culprit was ARCO's toxic Berkeley Lake, laden with poisons like copper, arsenic, cadmium. Others cast much broader nets, blaming the destructive system of corporate capitalism or an out-of-control consumer society with an insatiable desire for copper. Though the word had not yet been coined in 1995, all of these broader explanations also pointed to the finger of guilt towards something that we now have started to call the Anthropocene, or proposed to call it, or what National Geographic termed the Age of Man, a new geological epoch when humans have become a force of nature as powerful as earthquakes and hurricanes. So who or what really did kill the Berkeley Pit snow geese? Now, I can tell you what the scientific evidence suggests, and I promise that I will. Yet The hard numbers, the science can identify the murder weapon. I think the science says little about the identity and motives of the murderer. If we round up the usual suspects, industrial capitalism, corporate negligence, gluttonous consumers, I think we'd find that they probably all had a hand in the plot. But today, I want to suggest that the Berkeley Pit snow geese have something even more important to teach us. In fact, while we've been kept busy interrogating the usual suspects, I suspect the real killer has quietly slipped away. Now, the killer I have in mind is an idea. Really more of a bizarre article of faith that took root in Western Europe, was spread around the world at the tip of a sword, and has since found safe haven in the United States and almost every other modern nation. It is the pervasive belief that humans are the sole members of the most exclusive club on this planet, the club of unnatural species. Or species, I suppose I should say. Now, I throw in little clips like this to liven things up, but... Oh, sorry, I didn't plug in the sound. Shoot. Yeah, can you see if he can fix that? It's okay for this one. But yeah, hopefully we can plug in the sound because there's a couple more yet to come. So you couldn't hear that, but this is, of course, the African queen, Catherine Hepburn and Humphrey Bogart. And, well, I think too, Pat, we have to plug in the computer. Yeah. So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, we've got to get a line from the computer. I'm pretty sure, yeah, because there's no line running. Unless it's coming from your, let me go back and try it again. No, yeah. I think we'll need, if your tech guy can just run a line from the computer to to the speakers. Sorry, apologies, I forgot about the sound needing to be plugged in separately from the video. But in any event, if you could hear it, what you would hear is Bogart says, it's human nature. And then Catherine Hepburn replies that nature, Mr. Allnut, is what we are put in this world to rise above. Now, many of you might protest that whatever the indomitable Miss Rosie Sayer might believe, you don't think that humans are here to rise above their nature, whatever that might be, or even that humans are even unnatural. But I might, Pat, I might actually try to get the sound going if I could, because there's another video clip coming up, if the sound person is available at all. That would, because it, yeah, I think you would enjoy the other clip if we can do it somehow. Or that humans are even unnatural, right? Obviously, we evolved from nature. We still have more or less natural bodies. We depend on natural systems to provide us with energy, water, food. And if that's your objection, I entirely agree. But I want to take the point a bit further. I want to go after the longstanding Western belief that human culture is clearly unnatural and thus distinct and separate from nature. Now, there's what I want to go after is the sort of idea that human ideas, creativity, and especially technologies are what make us unnatural. That's when humans left the natural world. That nature might make our bodies, but our minds make culture. Those are distinct things. I want to stake out the contrary position, as Pat sort of alluded to in his introduction. I want to argue that much of what makes us most uniquely human actually comes from the creative and constantly changing environment, the material environment that we often refer to as nature. That we live not in an age of humans, I will argue, but in an age of things, a time when the powerful and sometimes dangerous things we've invited into our world increasingly shape who we are as human beings and what we might yet become. Now, the idea that our human intelligence, creativity, and culture actually emerge from the material environment might strike some of you as a bit strange. today we tend to think that humans have all of the creativity and ideas, and then they shape their material world. We think of things and we change the world. Not the other way around. But for much of our history as a species, most humans probably assumed the opposite, that a vibrant natural world helped to create humans in all of their dimensions, culture included. My anthropologist friends call these folks animists. Now, my intent here is not to romanticize the Achuar people. I've got a photo of a typical folks who are animist thinkers. I don't want to sort of romanticize them as sort of inherently wise and noble and proto-ecologists and so forth. That's not my intent. They're often wrong, right? They're often mistaken about how the natural world works around them. But my point is that for the vast majority of our history on this planet, most people, most humans, probably assumed that whatever it was that made humans special, whatever it was that made us different, came from nature, came from the natural world. So how is it that so many modern people now seem to sort of believe the opposite? Certainly many, many academics. I call this creating the club of unnatural species. Well, we can't be entirely sure how it happens, right? This happens over a long time, but a reasonable guess is that the core of this idea first emerged about 12,000 years ago, when some small bands of human beings in several spots around the globe began to abandon their traditional hunter-gatherer ways to take up farming and settle in permanent villages, what we later would call the Neolithic Revolution. Now, as their material environment became increasingly anthropogenic, it also became possible for these village dwellers to imagine that they had left nature behind altogether. In this sense, the idea emerged from the material nature of village living and farming. When you farm and you live in villages, you begin to think in new ways. You can think in new ways. So you see what I'm trying to reverse the idea. The idea comes from the experience, from acting and living certain ways. Now, let me give you another example you might be more familiar with, and that's Adam and Eve. Many scholars have pointed out that this ancient tale might have been an attempt to explain what happened during the Neolithic Revolution. While they're in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve lived in harmony with nature, just like hunter-gatherers. But when Eve ate that infamous fruit, God kicked them out of the garden, out of nature. They were thrust naked and shivering into a now hostile world. Adam and Eve could never again be a harmonious part of nature because they alone were the carriers of a supernatural soul that had been given to them by their God. Just sort of looking for the plug-in, hopefully. I would so much like you to hear this, but I don't see it.
We're able to find somebody. They're looking for somebody.
Are they that one? Wait, I think I see it. That looks like a sound cable to me. You would. Yeah, we'll have to, just one of them is fine. Okay, well, hopefully this will work. Because it's kind of a fun little clip. Okay. So the point is that a lot of, you know, this is not my idea. A lot of scholars have pointed out that the story of Adam and Eve sounds a lot like the Neolithic Revolution. You know, you leave nature, you leave Eden, and now you have to work and you have to farm and so forth. And this is precisely what Adam and Eve happened to them. It's an attempt to explain this. What happened? Why are we different? Why do humans act differently than other animals around us? There we go. Okay, my voice will be louder too, which for good or bad. Now, as the historian of technology, David Noble, argues, eventually this idea gets secularized. Now, many years later, this idea that we're separate, that we're distinct from nature, is sort of stripped of its more overtly religious elements, particularly in Western Europe. And instead of a divine soul, the rationalist thinkers, people like Descartes and so on, in the Age of Enlightenment, they argue that an abstract and immaterial human mind or intellect is what makes us different. So you can see the soul sort of becomes replaced by our mind, this disembodied mind. I mean, think of the philosopher René Descartes, who believed that the human intellect, like a soul, was entirely separate from the body and nature. I think, therefore I am, says Descartes. Descartes also concluded that since they didn't have minds like humans, all the other animals on the planet were really just machines or living automatons. In fact, the whole universe might be understood as a machine, the concept of a clockwork universe. Now that's very crude. I've sort of stuck 12,000 years of human history together here. This little thing is kind of noisy. So let me just pause here again to say that nothing I've said so far is actually particularly new or controversial. All of this is fairly well understood and well accepted. And here's some books if you would like to look at them. So we've long understood that this divergence between animist and Western ideas, which is what I'm getting at here, many have also wondered if we lost something when that happened, that we lost something vital when, either because of the religious or these intellectual reasons, we stripped away the idea that we come from nature, that we come from the material world. But for a long time, there just didn't seem to be any way to put them back in, you know, a way of reincorporating animist thought, at least, you know, not without sort of sounding like a nut, right? You sort of end up sounding like a New Age nut, you know, waiting for the Age of Aquarius or something like that. But now that's finally beginning to change, thanks to a lot of new bold insights coming out of science and the humanities. I think we can finally say we have the tools we need to get there, but that the key is to bring the material world back into our understanding of culture, to see culture as coming out of the material world. In that way, we can once again become natural-born humans, become part of nature. Now, so far, science has done most of the heavy lifting on this. And given that science emerged from the same rationalist Cartesian ideas I just have been criticizing, that might seem kind of odd. But because science at least tries to pay attention to the real material world, the scientific method almost immediately began to undermine the arrogance, the anthropocentrism that had created it. Copernicus showed the Earth, shoved the Earth from the center of the universe. Darwin showed that humans were just another animal. A century later, Rachel Carson taught us that we would never escape DDT and other chemicals in our environment. Quantum mechanics, chaos theory, neuroscience, the new science of microbiomes, the new science of epigenetics, many other scientific fields have continued to reveal and made even more apparent in the past decade all of the ways in which we're embedded in our material world. Now, unfortunately, until recently, most humanists like me, that's my tribe, were in no position to recognize that science was telling them something important about culture. To be fair, humanists had some good reasons for wanting to maintain a bright line distinction between culture and nature. But starting back in the 1980s, things also got a little nutty. Some of my colleagues sort of spun off into the extremes of postmodernism, post-structuralism, these sort of very human-centered ideas where you can get, this is Calvin and Hobbes, right? Where you can have somebody who wants to do, what is it? Monological imperatives in Dick and Jane, A Study of Psychic Translational Gender Modes. Right? That's kind of where a lot of humanists had ended up. And, you know, that's a cheap shot, and I admit that's a cheap shot, and I apologize to all the people in the audience who are humanists, and, you know, because I've been there too. But nonetheless, this is what had happened to a certain degree. And even the more reasonable scholars, the folks who weren't sort of enamored by post-structuralism and so forth, all of these modern theories, most of those people still were interested in how culture shaped the world, not how the world shaped culture. And they still assumed there was a clear distinction between those two spheres. But now, more recently, humanists have started to come back down to earth. The old postmodernist models are giving way to things that have new names. You don't need to know them, but new materialism, post-humanism, and whatever you want to call it, and I don't really care what you call it, but we're starting to think about how the material world makes our culture. Let me just give you a quick example from a very famous French anthropologist who studied the Achuar, the people I showed you in South America. His book is titled, this very point, Beyond Nature and Culture. And what he means is beyond the division, beyond that separation that has been with us so long. Okay, so boiled down, let me just reduce this to its very essence and do a little bit of damage to it, but perhaps not too much in doing so. I have two basic ideas that I want to throw out to you today. One is that the material environment, both in its natural and anthropogenic forms, plays a far bigger role in creating humans and their cultures than has been heretofore recognized. And two, given the first thesis, his humanists have to move beyond anthropocentrism and pay much more closer attention to the non-human world of organisms, of materials, of buildings like this, and other things that help to make us human. Now, if you want to know what I think the next big thing is, that's what it is. This is my bet. You know, who knows where this stuff is going? There's a lot of other people who are much smarter than me who have written about it and are writing about it. But instead of talking about sort of abstractions, let me sort of try to concretize this a little bit with one example, one brief example of how would this make us think differently? How would this change something as fundamental as what caused the Industrial Revolution? You can't get a bigger question than that, at least in Western historiography. Now, this example comes from my friend and colleague, Ed Russell, who appropriately enough, given what I've just been saying, he earned his PhD in biology at the University of Michigan before he decided he was going to be a historian. So he knows the science. So he's the best example of a scholar that I know who's sort of closing that gap between science and the humanities, or nature and culture. He's bringing them together. And he does it this way. Now, what I want you to do is think about the Industrial Revolution. Just take a few seconds right now. Think about the Industrial Revolution. Now, I'm guessing you thought of something like this. I could be wrong. But you thought of big smoky factories, long rows of human inventions like spinning mules and mechanical power looms. But unless you already read Ed's book, which is called Evolutionary History, I don't think many of you probably pictured this. Now, this is a cotton plant that grew in North America. And some native peoples there have begun to cultivate it at least 5,000 years ago, 5,000 years before the Industrial Revolution even began. Now, when Christopher Columbus returned to Spain from the New World, he proudly reported that he had discovered an unusually long fibered cotton plant. Columbus assumed that the plant was entirely natural. But recent genetic studies tell us that Columbus's discovery had actually co-evolved for millennia with several groups of native peoples who had selected it for longer fibers, partly just by chance. It's easier to pick it if it has long fibers. So they may not even have intended for this to happen. And there's some of the fibers you can compare. Now, here's the important thing. When you try to, for example, spin the old world short-fibered cotton, it's very difficult because the stress and strain of the mechanism tends to rip it apart. They would often break apart. Now, that didn't mean it was impossible. You could do it, but it was much less efficient, much more costly, much more difficult. So here's Russell's point. He says that one key to the successful industrialization of textiles in England, and thus the subsequent Industrial Revolution, was the arrival of large quantities of this new long fiber cotton from North America in the mid-18th century. Now, Russell is not trying to suggest that cotton created the Industrial Revolution, but what he is saying is he's taking issue with the tendency of most historians to just talk about humans, human inventors, human inventions, spinning mules, power, all the things you probably thought about. Now, Russell asks us to think, what was really new? What was really new when this happened? And to a significant degree, it was something that was created by a plant. It was the biological creativity of a cotton plant that was so powerful in creating this industrial revolution. Yet that story gets entirely left out of the typical anthropocentric way of thinking about it. Now, to my way of thinking, what this suggests is the Enlightenment thinkers, remember I showed you the clockwork universe, that they got it totally backwards. They got it totally backwards. That we live in something that might better be called the cottonseed universe. A universe that's created by the material power of the natural world. That this is really what's driving this. So the animist people that I told you about before, they got it right. They got this right. Even if they didn't understand the science particularly well. The Western folks have gotten the science right, but they lost something fundamental, some fundamental truth in the process. Now, finally, after a long sort of very fractious divorce, these two views, I think, are starting to gradually come back together. And what I argue is, what we're realizing is we never left Eden. If the story of Adam and Eve was about this separation between the soul and the intellect and the material world, that whether it was that or the Cartesian, that never happened. We're still in Eden. This is it right here in Butte. So if we're right about this, if it's true that humans in all their dimensions, if it's true that all humans in all their dimensions are at least partly created by nature, then much of who we are as modern humans, both good and bad, must come from the partnerships we have formed with material things. Humans are swimming in an ocean of powerful, and sometimes, as Pat alluded to, dangerous stuff. Indeed, some of the things like coal and oil are so powerful that they've radically changed the course of human history, pulling us into patterns of behavior and thinking that we didn't necessarily intend, but now find exceedingly difficult to escape. Now, to illustrate my point, we'll see if this actually works. I'm going to make one more quick pop culture reference to a television program that played way back in 1969. From the Star Trek series, and it's called The Way to Eden. Now, what happens in the story is Captain Kirk and his team beam down, there's this band of sort of hippies. They look like hippies, these sort of nature-loving hippies, and they hijack the starship Enterprise, and they force Captain Kirk to take them to this planet that they call Eden. Now, when Kirk and his team beam down, they discover it's covered with all these beautiful flowers and plants, seemingly a true Garden of Eden. But almost immediately, Lieutenant Sulu burns his hand on a flower. So it turns out that all those beautiful plants actually secrete acid, and they bear poisonous fruits. Now we'll see if this works. It doesn't. Oh, it's a shame.
Can you put your microphone onto it?
It might work. I could try. Because it is kind of... Yeah, it is. I'll turn it all the way up. Maybe you could sort of hear. But yeah, he says, you know, Bone says it's poison, the fruit is deadly. And his name was Adam. So it's this play on the Adam and Eve story, obviously, but with a kind of an interesting twist, right? That the planet is poisonous. Now, I'm not a Trekkie, but I've heard that Trekkies hate this episode. They think it's terrible. And I can sort of see why. It's pretty hackneyed. But what I want you to sort of think about for my purposes is it has an interesting idea, and that's this. What if a seemingly beneficent and benevolent and nurturing planet is actually really dangerous? What if it's actually a dangerous place? And you don't quite see it until it's too late. So now, humans are over 7 billion. We have obviously, humans have become an extraordinarily successful species by any stretch of the imagination. But as I've been trying to suggest, humans accomplish these things only by partnering with other organisms, things like cotton and copper and coal and oil. And these things have a lot of power that we don't really necessarily understand or necessarily really control. We sort of surf on them. We use them, but we don't necessarily control them. So I wonder if it's a bit like a real-life version of Star Trek's fictional planet Eden. The Earth might now be showing itself to be actually a fairly hostile place, with deadly things that any species with a modest allotment of intelligence and an opposable thumb can all too quickly use to destroy themselves, as well as many other living things around them. And that brings us back to the geese. So, the night that the snow geese, arrived in Butte, the evidence suggests they were confused. Now, the previous spring, all but the very youngest had flown the opposite direction, north beyond the Arctic Circle, where they had nested along the tundra shoreline of far northern Alaska and Canada. Now, we can't say precisely where all of those geese had summered, but one of them was banded. So we know that she came from Wrangel Island, which is a rocky outcrop in the Siberian Arctic. Now, if possible, geese always return to the places they were born in order to breed. And there, they sometimes form these immense colonies of thousands of birds. Snow geese mate for life, and there among the multitude of the couples, somehow find each other and begin the serious business of reproducing the next generation. Now, regardless of where they came from, we know that with the approach of winter, the elder geese and their offspring began to form their flocks at a staging area and head to the south. Snow geese and other migratory waterfowl of North America follow four great aerial highways during their biannual journeys north and south. To find their way, the geese appear to have a rough sense of direction reckoned by the position of sun and stars, maybe the magnetic field. But the precise path that they follow is something they only learn from older geese. As one wildlife biologist observes, migratory wildfowl know how to migrate, but not specifically where. Among these birds, and unlike almost all others, the details are bound up in what he calls tradition, passed on by older generations. Now, ornithologists believe the geese find their way, at least in part, by following a chain of familiar landmarks. Wetlands, mountains, rivers, of course, but also towns, highways, wheat fields, perhaps even open pit mines. Now, over the past century and a half, many of the wetlands the geese once depended on were drained and replaced with millions of acres of industrial farms. But rather than being a disaster, geese and other waterfowl quickly learned to eat what the farmers have left behind. Fortified by energy-rich rice, wheat, and other domesticated grasses, the snow geese also found protection in game laws and refuges that humans had preserved or created, primarily hunters had created. Now, after collapsing in the early 20th century, snow geese populations have since exploded, even to the point where they are damaging their fragile northern nesting grounds. Now, the birds have done far more than just unthinkingly adapt to their increasingly anthropogenic environment. Rather, they have exploited it. They have exploited it to create what we might not unreasonably think of as a new snow geese culture, a new way of living. In this, the snow geese are rather more like humans than we might initially think. They are no more natural than human beings are unnatural. Instead of drawing a clear line between humans and snow geese, we might do better to recognize how the two species have both been created by, and sometimes trapped by, their material world. Now, obviously, big-brained humans have been far more bold about tapping into the planet's material potentials than have snow geese. Indeed, the Berkeley pit itself emerged from our need for copper, our devotion to copper, and what it can provide. Yet in their own more modest way, the geese too have learned to exploit the caloric energy of farmers' fields. They've thrived as a species. They've exploded in population, even as they become ever more deeply entangled with a useful but potentially dangerous anthropogenic world. Now, when the snow geese arrived in Butte that November night 20 years ago, they'd already been incorporating human artifacts into their own ways for at least a century. So why not also use this strange lake? This brings us back to who killed the snow geese. Now, unfortunately, snow geese are also much like humans in that their biochemical metabolism is ill-prepared to handle highly acidic, heavy metal-bearing water. Now, as Arco said, two of the birds had indeed eaten some poisonous fungus. But as the subsequent final scientific report makes clear, that was a bit of a red herring that sowed a lot of sort of unjustified doubt and confusion that has lingered to this day. In truth, the scientific evidence was pretty unambiguous. Of the 17 other birds that were autopsied, whose corpses were examined, not one of them showed any evidence of having consumed poison grain. Yet the postmortem showed that 100% of the geese had small lesions in their throats, trachea, larynx, gizzard, and mouth. 100% also had kidney damage, extremely elevated levels of metals in their livers. Now, geese will die if the copper in their livers goes above about 55 micrograms per kilogram. The livers of all the Butte snow geese tested had copper concentrations well above this, a few as high as 174 micrograms. So we can imagine what happened that night. Blown off course, tired and hungry and thirsty, seeking shelter from the storm, the geese decided to gamble on that strange body of water that is the Berkeley Lake. Within some hours of drinking the pit water, though, the geese would have begun to suffer severe abdominal pain, nausea, and diarrhea. As their bodies struggled to filter out and excrete the onslaught of copper and other metals, the accumulating poisons began to destroy their kidneys and livers. Soon after, their heartbeats became weak and irregular, their long necks bent down to the water for the last time, and their dead or dying bodies slipped quietly beneath the waves. Briefly, improbably, the Berkeley pit had for a short time exploded with raucous, keening life. Then, unmoved, the giant pit calmly smoothed the surface of its dark waters and settled back into its accustomed shadowy silence. Now, two decades later, few outside of Butte in Montana remember the Berkeley pit snow geese. The birds disappeared from the wider national memory as quickly as they disappeared beneath the acidic pit water. Now, perhaps this is to be expected. Indeed, in a time of global mass extinctions and all too many horrific human tragedies, it seems fair to ask, what's to be gained in remembering the Butte snow geese? Surely we have more pressing problems to deal with. But if you followed my arguments before this, maybe you'll sort of agree with me when I say that it would only be a people who are dangerously deluded about their own place on the planet who would dare to ignore something as ominous as this. Indeed, as tragic as those deaths were in and of themselves, it would be an even greater tragedy if the birds had died in vain. Now, the historic human relationship with snow geese is not nearly so intimate as it has been with other organisms like cotton, cattle, or even dogs. But the geese are still a particularly evocative part of the world that makes us. When those birds die, some small part of who we are died with them. On the grand scale of things, maybe that doesn't mean much. But repeated 1,000, 1,000,000 times over, all around the world every day, as countless creatures, great and small, are thoughtlessly killed or pushed into extinction, we are quickly destroying the very things that make us most human. The first source of our intelligence, our creativity, what I would call our souls. In this sense, the death of the Butte snow geese was not so much a murder as it was a sort of cultural suicide. Now, if that starts to sound like I'm some sort of old revivalist tent preacher forecasting hell and damnation, it's not a role that I would necessarily shun. But I'm actually guardedly optimistic that humans can and will change course. Maybe it's just the self-delusion of a parent of two young children who refuse to concede that their future world looks bleak. But I take heart from knowing that tonight, as we speak, the Earth still remains an extraordinarily rich and creative place. If we can just manage to disentangle ourselves from some of our more crude and imperious material partners, there are still countless other clever organisms and materials that might yet lead us in new directions. So now my pitch. Finally, one of the really empowering things about this kind of materialist way of thinking is that it suggests that if you change your material environment, you change culture, you change ideas, just through the simple act of changing the things that are around us. The things that surround us have power. Now, after the snow geese died, a few of the good citizens of Butte tried to establish some sort of memorial to the birds. They didn't succeed at that time. Perhaps the wounds were too fresh, the controversies too sharp. But now, as we mark the 20th anniversary since the snow geese died, my hope is that that kind of dark milestone might yet spark the creation of at least some sort of modest memorial for the snow geese. Now, I'm an academic, you know, I'm a historian, I'm not an organizer, a community activist or anything. It's not something I particularly know how to do. But I'm willing to try. And I'm hoping, this is my pitch, that some of you might be willing to help me. If you would like to help, there's a couple of things you can do. One is, you can go to my website, there it is, and you can click on the Berkeley Pit Snow Geese Project. And it'll take you to a sign-up page where you can sign up for a newsletter. I won't ask you for money. All I'll do is send information as the project evolves and changes. Now, I first gave a much longer version, or somewhat longer version, of this talk last November in Bozeman. And since then, there's been some real progress. The most exciting thing is that my colleague at Montana State University, Professor Melissa Reagan, has devoted her entire class this semester, it's a class in public art, to the theme of envisioning what a snow geese memorial might look like. Her students have come up with some great ideas, many of which, very wisely, I think, honor both the snow geese and the miners and the people of Butte, right? That brings them together in a very powerful way, because they've all sacrificed in many ways to bring copper to the world, to create electrification. And here's just a few images. Now, she had a competition and she picked the best ones. Those will be on display tomorrow night at 5 o'clock over at the Imagine Butte Resource Center. Please go if you can. Please go and support them. You know, I don't know if one of these will work out or not, but there's certainly some very intriguing ideas that have been brought up. And my hope is that once we have a design of some sort, we can go to funding organizations, Montana Humanity Council Committee, others, and hopefully raise some money to actually make this happen. I think it could be a very good thing for Butte, for the snow geese, and just for humans in general, to make this happen. It would be a very unusual thing. There, you can count on one hand memorials to non-human species around the globe. There just aren't not very many, and most of the ones that are like war horses or the passenger pigeon is a better example. Okay. Just to conclude then, I'm running out of time. In a lot of ways, I think that Butte is the perfect place for this to happen, is the perfect place for us to begin to rethink and start to reimagine ways in which humans and other species can more effectively share this planet and understand their relationship, how they're entangled. As many of you know, today the pit is the most visited tourist site in Butte. But not very many tourists stay there very long. And I think that a lot of them feel a certain amount of relief as they climb back into their cars and they drive away. And they believe that they've left that pit behind. They left it behind in their rearview mirror. But they haven't. In truth, I think places like Berkeley Pit can't be left behind. Because in creating the pit, humans they didn't change some separate place, some place that's out there or in Butte that you can leave behind. They changed who they were. We changed who we were as a species and as a people. So for better or worse, that pit is who we humans have now become. All of us, whatever place you may call home. Yet if the Berkeley Pit snow geese can teach us just one thing, I hope that it is this, that we humans may be foolish. We may at times be careless, greedy, arrogant, but we are not, and never will be, unnatural. We may believe that we've abandoned nature, but I'm convinced that nature and the snow geese have not abandoned us. So, I'll say thank you, and as the IBRC folks have started to say, may the flock be with you. Thank you for your attention. I love that saying. If there are questions, right.
Have there been any incidents of geese or other birds landing in the way since? Do you know the answer to this?
Well, you know that.
Right.
The question, do you want me to pee him or do you want to do it, Pat? It
doesn't matter. If you could just repeat the question so it's on record.
Okay. I gotcha. Oh, I see. And the question was, have there been other incidents of geese or other waterfowl who have landed in the pit? Maybe some isolated. I mean, they still come, but of course now ARCO keeps them off, right? So they have recordings of predators, of hawks and eagles. They also have a gun that goes off if the geese get out there, if they land. And apparently, if they still won't leave, they'll actually get in a boat and go off and scare them off. So de facto, they've admitted that, yeah, the pit will kill waterfowl if they land there. So they do get them off.
Is there anyone here from the Bureau?
Yeah, who might know?
Could I understand some of the people that monitor water on the Bureau that you find dead birds routinely?
No, I have never found a dead bird. Oh, well, Ed has. He found the geese.
Oh, you were there?
Yeah. There are ducks on the pond, on the Berkeley Pit, every time I've been down there. And they're hard to chase off. You try to chase them off, they just dive and come up a couple hundred yards away. For a bird to die in the Berkeley Pit, it's got to be there a while. And that's why the snow geese died, because they got trapped in there with the storm and couldn't see to fly out.
Right. You know, if they hadn't stayed such a long time, they probably would have been fine.
Yeah.
No, I think that's...
Thank you for the question.
Which leads me to ask you, why do you think these birds were blown off course when I've got them flying over my house all the time, especially this time of year right now?
Yeah, you know.
They're migrating.
Right, sure, they're migrating. And they might, some of the birds might routinely come this way, but if you look at the way the ornithologists have mapped it, this part goes to the east of the divide. But it's close, it's very close to the divide, so I could easily see birds crossing over. But I just meant that it was a very stormy night. Perhaps they were lost, maybe they didn't routinely fly over Butte, that particular flock.
Because these birds, I mean, they fly over here.
Yeah, right.
Non-stop, those particular birds chose to.
Okay, well, and as I understand it, there used to be a lot of wetlands up in the Summit Valley, so it sort of makes sense, before they began to pump the water, that the flats was swampy. It was a swampy region. So maybe historically the geese also flew over Butte. I don't know.
Tim, I'm going to go back to Paul Main, our resident duck hunter and outdoor
writer. I would just suggest that we are a regular spot on the geese migration. And for example, last Thursday night, which was a prelude before last Friday's big snowstorm, about 10 o'clock at night, you went outside, you would hear thousands of geese talking in the night, because they were obviously looking for a place to rest for the night.
And John? I would just ask how your studies and your philosophy has changed the impact.
The way that I have lived? Oh, so what he asks is, how have these studies and my philosophy changed the way that I live?
You have a postcard with a pit in your car.
Pardon me?
So you take a postcard with a pit in your car and you visualize.
No. I guess I write different books, right? And I hope that people read my books and they think about these ideas. I'm not sure how much, you know, certainly we can all try to use less resources, and I do my best as much as anybody in this room probably does. But, you know, I think it has to be a much bigger sort of shift in the way we look at the world. And I think we have to begin changing things. We have to begin changing our material environment, and then the ideas will kind of come after that. That's sort of my hope. But ironically, of course, I'm putting an idea out there, aren't I? I'm suggesting that people think in different ways. Who knows whether that will actually get any traction. Yeah.
I'm having a hard time, in my own mind, seeing how the situation of snow geese and such is profoundly different than all the geese that Peel said yesterday when a plane took off in Boston.
Oh, did they?
Yeah. Or when all the deer that got killed yesterday.
Yeah.
So what makes the Berkeley pit different?
Yeah.
Is it the fact that it looks so bad? Or that it stays in one place?
Perhaps. I mean, his question was, yeah, what makes the Berkeley pit different? Because snow geese and other animals die routinely every day in, you know, around the globe. I think partly my response would be that after it happened, people immediately began to use it as a sort of way of thinking about the failure of humans, right? They contrasted the pit with the purity, the northern white purity of these geese who were destroyed by humans. I think that's the wrong way to think about it. I think what you're saying is quite right. You know, we always are going to harm other species. That's part of being an organism on this planet. You have to eat, you have to consume energy that comes from other species. But that's why I think the pit is such an evocative thing. We can push back against that, right? We can say, actually, this story is more interesting than that. That these pit, the animals, the geese who died in the pit are a lot like us. They're not that different from us. That we humans have to grapple with this as well, that the geese have to grapple with it as well. So I think it's just a very evocative story in a way that the geese being killed in Boston by an aircraft just will never be.
Right? If I could add to that, Tim, I know Chris is an avid trout fisherman, fly fisherman. So give him a reading assignment, Richard Brodigan's Trout Fishing in America, and it has a section, a little reading in it, called Death by Port Wine. And it's about someone who catches a trout and pours port wine down its throat. And it's portrayed as a great wrongful action in the book, because it's perfectly okay to catch a trout and break its neck and cook it. But it's deeply wrong to kill it by pouring port wine down its throat. Huh. I say that only a little bit.
Yeah. And could I just add one other thing to that, because you're getting me to think. One of the proposals that was put forward for the memorial, she had a really interesting idea. She said, let's not just talk about the geese, let's talk about all other animals. This could be sort of a national holiday. a holiday, a memorial day for animals who have been killed, either intentionally or unintentionally, just a moment for humans to pause and think about the consequences, the costs of the way we live. What a great idea. What a profound thing. Just one day out of the year. Stop, think. Yeah, this has benefited us, but there have been costs. There have been costs.
But it seems to me that what's dramatic about this is it's very unusual. I mean, we kill the power lines, we kill the birds all the time, the wind machines, we kill the birds all the time, we kill the air on the highway, we all these things. But that's kind of an even flaw. This was dramatic for one shot thing.
Right. Yeah.
And that's why I really got attention.
Yeah, and it's as you were saying, it was a special circumstance. Things had to conspire in a certain way for that to happen. But it did. It did happen, and it's a very evocative story. And I think for most people it's a story they think about to criticize Butte, to sort of say Butte's such this horrible place, these snow geese die. I don't think that's the only story to be told here. I think there's a much bigger story to be told that's more interesting.
I have a question here from Glenn. Tim, I'm hoping you will pardon this question because on one hand it is going to require a degree of speculation derived from your thesis, and it'll also elicit a postmodern response. So I'm hoping that there will be some forgiveness on that. Contemporary historians frequently offer a narrative of contemporary history using information as a core theme. The information age, there will be descriptions of it being very disembodied, very detached from the natural world, for an expression. If you wanted to invoke a new materialist historiography in response to that, what would that look like?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really great question. It is a bit postmodern-y. But so he was asking, though there's all sorts of things, particularly in the modern world, that are information-based. We live in an information age, which seems relatively immaterial, I think. And it's semiotic, it's communication. And I wouldn't deny that at all. But what I would say is, for example, there's still a materiality for books. Who controls books? Who can print books? Who has the resources to make books, to make newspapers, right? To create that kind of information, there is power that goes into it. There's materiality to it. Now, I had an interesting conversation about a year ago with a guy who works for Microsoft. He was talking about their servers and how much energy it takes to keep those computer servers, these big network servers, going. They're hugely material, right? So, I'm not trying to say there's not this immense symbolic power that comes from the semiotics of language. I wouldn't say that. But I would want to, let's also point out that there are other aspects to it that matter. Who has the power to focus that, to make that kind of information?
Yeah. Other questions? Going once?
Can you open up the auditor?
The dog.
The dog.
Yes, I have read about the dog. Yeah, I have heard of that. And that's an interesting story too, isn't it?
Well, that dog was definitely created by the natural environment.
Yeah, right.
He was the...
Right, yeah, yeah.
His dog ties into the experience.
Yeah, it's an issue. Yeah, yeah. It's a great thought. I can use that.
Second question.
Back to your point about who has the power to print the words, yearly or every other year there's a story about the birds being hazed off of the pit.
Uh-huh.
And it's always made to seem like it's a very successful venture. They don't mention, at least Montana Standard doesn't mention, that there's still a reasonable number of fatalities. So that kind of leads me to think that if we had a little more truth in those reports, that we'd all be better off, perhaps.
Right. Yeah. No, I certainly agree. He was saying that there's still a lot of fatalities. Birds are still dying in the pit. to this day, but yeah.
So, question.
Frequently it comes up in the conversation about, you know, wind turbines being harmed with birds.
Yeah.
And well, there's people going out underneath them all the time counting the dead birds. These people in Berkeley have been counting the dead birds. Has anyone done a control to see what the average background bird death is?
You mean just sort of, yeah, it's an interesting thought, isn't it? Just for the, for a region or something, what the...
For a cultural area, or a industrial area, or a national wildlife area.
Right.
You go out walking the Oslo Park, you're going to find dead birds in there.
Right.
You walk under a wind turbine, you're going to find dead. So what is the control?
Yeah.
What is the average mortality of dead birds per acre or per
I don't know. I don't know about that. It would certainly be interesting to find out. Well, I don't know that it is. I mean, the snow geese are not endangered. They're overpopulated, if anything. I'm not trying to make an argument that the reason we need to preserve them is because we need to save the species or something. I'm saying that what can we not, as a species, muster enough empathy and care to say that the poor birds died in that pit and that we're sorry it happened? I mean, do we need to reduce it to, well, it was only 342 out of 5,000 that die in, around the planet every day? People die all the time too. We manage to care about that. I'm just, you know, you see what I'm saying? It's more of a leap of will and imagination and of empathy to extend this. And my sort of thesis is, if we could just start to do that, we would become better people. We would become a better species, if just by making the effort, is kind of what my hope is. I don't really have any evidence of that. It hasn't happened yet, but.
We'll take one final question. We're running a little long on the last question.
So okay. I'm sorry?
I'll be a contrarian.
Okay.
Compared to the death rate of humans in underground mining that have taken place in view.
Right.
And I have no idea, but I would guess there's very few people that have died in either of the pits. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't.
Yeah, no. Well, that's what my first book is about.
Yeah.
It's about the transition from the underground mining to the pit. And you're right, the pit is vastly safer. You know, just astronomically safer than underground mining. Yeah, right, right. I mean, I'm uncomfortable with trying to make these sort of trade-offs and comparisons, and it's sort of like this, and I just want, it just seems to me, again, to be useful to just take them on their own merits and look at that story and look what happened to those individual geese. It happened in this place, and it seems like this would be the place to think about it seriously and find some way to move forward with it.
Oh, one last, just because you're my student.
There we go. Question is, there's a viewing stand for Berkeley Pit. Like, how does that kind of change the dynamic? People have to pay $2 to go look at this big hole in the ground with waste in it that, you know, is acidic and is killing animals. Does that kind of just, I guess, how does that shape your argument? Like, is it something to be looked at and kind of criticized, or is this something that you said people walk away and kind of leave that area? But what does it mean when somebody has to pay $2 to go see, you know, today's boulder?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, what is it? He asked, what does it mean that people have to pay money, $2, used to be a dollar, $2 to go out and see the Berkeley Pit on a viewing stand? That's less than ideal, of course, but then they have costs that they have to keep up, and that they need some profit, I suppose, to keep it going. It's certainly better than the alternative of shutting it down. But if there is some sort of memorial, or whether it's a memorial just to the geese or maybe to the miners, a lot of these proposals do both, right? They suggest there's a parallel there. I hope it would be free, right? That would be great. It should be free, but whether or not we can actually swing that entirely depends on donors, getting enough people excited about it. You know, if the people of Butte don't want to do it, it's not going to happen. No question about that, so.
Okay, thank you everyone for coming, and thank you.
Thank you.